Geometry is one of the oldest mathematical forms. It dates back thousands of years BC. In this chapter, we're going to be talking about subjects or topics in geometry, and we're going to begin with vocabulary. We're going to talk about a lot of ideas that are associated with one another. By the way, the original mathematicians who studied geometry were really just interested in measurement. And in fact, geometry means earth measure. The geo part means earth, and the metri refers to measurement, so earth measurement. Anyway, let's talk about some vocabulary topics. Space is that which extends in all directions, and we have an idea of outer space and that kind of thing, but we might talk about the space within this studio, for example, or something like that. Now, I can't really draw a picture of space, but I can certainly draw a picture of an object which may be in space, and spatial objects are generally objects which have a three-dimensional quality, and I can kind of depict that, even though I'm using a flat surface here, I can depict that like this. So you kind of get the feeling that this has some depth to it, and in fact maybe I can do this to give it a little more idea of that depth. So what I have here is basically a box. Now, objects in space are often called solids, and there are a lot of geometric solids that come into play in the study of geometry. This is just one of them. A plane is just a flat surface. We might talk about the flat surface of the floor, or the flat surface of this wall, or the flat surface of this chalkboard. And objects that are drawn on a plane are called plane figures, and a plane figure might be a triangle. So I might draw a triangle here. It would be a plane figure because it is wholly contained within the plane of this chalkboard. A line is a set of points which extend infinitely far in two directions. And lines are often depicted using an illustration like this. Now notice the arrows at the ends of the line indicate that the line extends infinitely far in these two directions. Now, a part of a line is called a line segment, and when a line segment is depicted, we generally have endpoints associated with line segments, and usually we label those endpoints with letters like this. So this is line segment AB. Now, a line is a set of points. A line segment is a set of points. But it's often the case that we want to measure line segments. And so we can measure the length of the line segment, you see, using a ruler or something like that. So we refer to the measure, we refer to the line as kind of like separate ideas. But a lot of times in our study, when we say when we refer to a number associated with a line segment, we're talking about the length of the line segment. And that kind of makes sense. We're not going to take an issue with differentiating between the length of a segment and the fact that the segment is really a set of points. We're not going to argue about that here. I think it'll all become clear as we study this idea. For example, here in this illustration, we have three points that lie on this line. Now, this line, by the way, can be named in a lot of different ways. In a formal study of geometry, when you name a line using points on the line, you use a little indicator above the letters. For example, if I want to talk about a line, let's say AB. Now, line AB is the line containing the points A and B. And in geometry, I would do this. I would say, this is line AB, and to really point out that it's line AB that I'm talking about, then I would put this designation on it. And if I was talking about segment AB, you see, then I would do this. I would say segment AB is this. You see, so we have these kinds of this kind of notation involved in a formal study of geometry. We're not going to worry about that formal notation, though. When we talk about segments here, we're just going to use letters for the segments, and we're not going to worry about whether we're thinking about a set of points here or the length. Gee, by the context of this, it's obvious that we're talking about the length. So I'm labeling this as, let's see, between A and B is 5 units, between B and C is 3 units. So segment AB is 5 and segment BC is 3. It should make some sense from the illustration that this distance plus this distance is equal to this distance. So we can actually create a little relationship, a little equation type of relationship about these three segments. So we would say that AB plus BC is equal to AC. And therefore, it's pretty easy for us to find the distance AC. You see, the length of that segment. And it would be that AB is 5, BC is 3, and AC is the sum of these two, or 8. Now, suppose I change the problem around a little bit, though. Suppose I say that AB is 15. And I'll take these off for a moment. I say that AB is 15, and I say that AC is, oh, let's say 25. Now, I still have the same relationship. That is, I know that AB plus BC is AC. But in this situation, I'd like to, well, let me label this first. AB is 15, and AC is 25. That's all of this. So this entire distance is 25. Now, it may be clear to you the arithmetic that needs to be performed in order to find BC, but whether it's clear to you or not, the actual calculation, we can certainly use this relationship to find BC, because after all, AB plus BC is AC. So AB is given as 15, AC is given as 25, and now we can solve the equation. And subtracting 15 on both sides, we find that the 15s go out, we find that BC is equal to 10. Now, you may have thought, you may have realized earlier that all we need to do is take 15 from 25 and we're left with BC. And that's what we're doing here. That's the calculation we're performing. We're just doing it in the context of an equation right here. Parallel lines are two lines that are in the same plane, that is, on the same flat surface, which never intersect. And if they never intersect, it means that they are the same distance apart anywhere you measure that distance. So right here, they would be the same distance apart as they would be right here, and as they would be 100 miles in that direction or 100 miles in this direction, because lines extend infinitely far in the two directions, you see. So parallel lines, the notation for parallel is this notation. Now notice that I'm naming this line. This is line AB, this is line CD. So I'm saying here that line AB is parallel with line CD. Now there are only two conditions for a couple of lines that are in the same plane. They either intersect or they don't intersect. Now if they don't intersect, they're parallel lines. If they intersect, then they are called intersecting lines. Now, here are a couple of lines. Sometimes there's confusion about this. Sometimes people think that these two lines might be parallel lines because I'm not showing them as intersecting lines. I'm not showing the intersection point, you see. But certainly these are not parallel because, after all, they're not the same distance apart at these points as at these points. And they will clearly, as this line extends this way and that one extends this way, they will clearly intersect. So this is a picture of intersecting lines, even though we don't show the point of intersection. A ray can be thought of as a half line. It is a figure which starts at a point and extends infinitely far in only one direction. And to describe a ray, we generally use two points. And in formal geometry, the ray idea is described this way. For ray DE, you would write the letters D and E, and you would start at D, and you would kind of extend like this with a little notation. You know that little upper notation for the letters that I showed you earlier for line and segment extend to the idea of ray. Now, we're not using this kind of notation in this study, but I just want to let you know that this is a possibility. Angles. Angles are formed when two rays have the same endpoint. So we're really talking about the bringing together the ray BA and ray BC. So we have two rays here. They have a common endpoint, and an angle is formed. Now, an angle technically is just a set of points. It would be all the points on this ray along with all the points on that ray. But a lot of times when we talk about angles, we are talking about the opening between those two rays. And we talk about, therefore, the measure of the angle. Now, angles can be named in a lot of different ways. If we're using the letters that we have here in this illustration, this angle could be called angle ABC. It could also be called angle CBA, CBA. But when this three-letter notation is used, the middle letter is always at this common endpoint for the two rays. Now, that common endpoint is called the vertex of the angle. So this middle letter is at the vertex of the angle all of the time. Now, if there's no confusion, it's okay to name an angle with a single letter. I'm going to erase this just a moment. So we could use this single letter B, and there would be no confusion about what angle we're talking about. But if I put another ray in here, you see, if I had a ray right here, and we said angle B, you see, and let me just put another letter in here as well, then there would be confusion because we wouldn't know if we were talking about angle ABD, angle DBC, or angle ABC, you see, just by using the single letter B. So a lot of times to take that confusion out, we have to use the three-letter designation. Another way to name angles is to somehow label the opening. And a lot of times the opening is labeled with a number such as 3 or 1 or 2 or whatever. But therefore this then could be called angle 3 if we wanted to call it by that name. Now the angles are measured in degrees, and it is the opening, you see, between the rays that's measured. And you may already be familiar with the idea, but if we kind of make a square corner here, like this, and a corner is made with this ray and this ray, then that's 90 degrees. And if I take these two rays and I go all the way around, open, 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 all the way around, you see, and come back to the same place where I started, that's 360 degrees. And 1/4 of that would be this corner business, and that's a right angle. That brings us to the next item up here. A right angle is an angle of 90 degrees, and a lot of times the notation used in that 90 degree right angle is this little corner notation between the two rays. Perpendicular lines are intersecting lines which form right angles. So if we have a right angle formed and these two lines, when these two lines intersect, then the two lines are perpendicular. The notation for perpendicular is this. Not a big surprise, is it? It kind of looks like it's a perpendicular situation. But so we would say here that line P is perpendicular with line Q. And that's what this notation is telling us. Now, if the two lines are perpendicular when they intersect to form a right angle, then certainly segments within those lines intersecting to form a right angle would be perpendicular. So here, if I designate points A, B, and up here C, D, then I could say that A, B, segment A, B, is perpendicular with segment C, D. So I could say that. Now, complementary angles are angles which add to 90 degrees. So two angles whose sum is 90 degrees would be complementary. Now, complementary angles are a lot of times depicted like this. If you just kind of take an overall right angle and then draw a ray, you see, inside the right angle, then you have a couple of angles which are complementary, because it's pretty clear that the sum of these two will be 90. And I've labeled them here 70 degrees and 20 degrees. But the angles don't have to be contained within a right angle like this. They just have to add to 90 degrees. So if I have these two angles separated, you see, a 70 degree angle and a 20 degree angle, then certainly those two are complementary. Now, you know, let me go back up here just a minute and mention something about perpendicular lines and something I mentioned before. I said that if the lines are perpendicular, then the segments along the lines would be perpendicular to one another. And that's true with that parallel idea before. We talk about parallel lines, but we could talk about parallel segments. And I failed to mention that a few minutes ago. So if we just take a couple of lines which are parallel and then select segments off of those lines, then the segments would be parallel as well. It only makes sense, doesn't it? Here's an angle which is a straight angle. It's called a straight angle because of what it looks like. If we're thinking about an opening, now just imagine this being gone for a moment, but if I took this as one side of the angle and then I opened a ray like this, I just kind of make it bigger, 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 bigger until it goes just in the opposite direction, then that's how a straight angle is formed. Now, a straight angle can be thought of as really two right angles. You see, we have a right angle over here and a right angle over here. So it's not surprising that the measure of a straight angle is 180 degrees. Now, the straight angle can be named. You see, it is named the same way, using the same convention as before. So it is AOB for this straight angle. Supplementary angles are two angles whose sum is 180 degrees. And once again, the two angles can be depicted in an illustration like this, where if I have a third ray that kind of goes off like this, then the angle, well, I'll go ahead and write it. Then this angle along with this angle, you see, together are supplementary angles. And each one is said to be the supplement of the other. And here are a couple of supplementary angles as well. Now, these are not sort of attached to one another to form a straight angle, but the sum of them is 180 degrees, and so they are supplements. An acute angle is an angle that is between 0 and 90 degrees. And an acute angle, an illustration, would be something like this. See, so this angle is an angle that is an acute angle. An obtuse angle is one which is greater than 90 degrees but less than 180 degrees. So an illustration would be something like this. You see, greater than 90 but less than 180, and I'm talking about this opening. Suppose we want to find the complement of a 25 degree angle. The complement. Now we have to remember what complementary angles are. Complementary angles are angles whose sum is 90 degrees. So let's see. An angle plus its complement is 90. We can make an equation out of it if we want to. We can say, well, let's see. An angle plus its complement, I don't know the complement, I'll just say n, is equal to 90 degrees. So to find the complement, I will need to subtract 25 on both sides. So I would find, let's see, if I use this notation, the 25s go out and I find n to be, let's see, 90 minus 25 is 65. So it's 65 degrees. Now, you may have already thought, when I was setting this up, you might think to yourself, well, gee, the two angles total 90 degrees, so in order to find the other angle, I have to take 90 degrees and subtract 25. And if you do it like that, that's fine. If you want to set up the equation format for that process, then that's fine as well. Suppose we want to find the measure of angle A in this illustration. Now, let's get a grip on the illustration first. And you may have to study illustrations in geometry because they sometimes look a little convoluted. They look a little complicated. So take a moment to study the figure. Now the opening right here is the opening for A, and that's the angle we're looking for. And this opening, you see, is the 70 degree angle that's noted here. This 120 degrees is this entire opening. So all of this is 120, and this piece of it is 70 degrees. And so to find A, should it be any surprise that all we have to do is take 120 and subtract 70? Now, once again, we could make an equation out of the situation. We could just by observation notice that angle A plus the 70 degree angle gives us the overall angle of 120, and that would give us the equation A plus 70 degrees, or just 70 if you want to for in, within the equation, is equal to 120. And now solving this for A means that we would subtract 70 on both sides to find A to be, let's see, 120 minus 70, oh, that's 50. And we're talking about an angle, so it's 50 degrees for angle A. A triangle is defined as a closed, three-sided plane figure. Let's talk about what that means. Here's an illustration of a triangle. Now, notice that it has three sides, and there are also three angles involved. And the notion of three is kind of indicated with the name tri. The prefix tri means three, so this name really says three angles. All right, so we do have three angles, we have three sides. Now, the closure business refers to this, that the end points of all of the sides kind of join with one another. Here's an illustration of a three-sided figure which is not closed. Here's one side, here's another side, and now here's another side. Now, notice we don't have closure because this end point doesn't join with that one. When you have closure, when figures are closed, you can kind of identify sort of an inside and an outside for the figure. Okay, so that's the notion of closed. Now, it's a plane figure because it's a figure that lies in one plane. It can be drawn on a flat surface, so that's all that refers to. A couple of items of interest here in terms of labeling. There is a base and a height that are related to one another involved in a triangle, and actually there's more than one base-height combination. The base refers to any side, and usually it's the bottom side that is depicted as the base. So let's call this the base. The height is the shortest distance from the base to the opposite vertex. Now, this B is a vertex point, and the shortest distance would be the perpendicular distance. So it would be this distance for the height. Now, I said there are several base-height combinations. It's possible for us to refer to segment BC as the base, and the height then would be the distance from BC over to A. You see, that would be a base-height combination. There'd be another one with AB as, if AB is the base, then a distance from AB over to C would be the height. But as I say, generally it is the bottom side that's depicted as the base and this vertical segment as the height. One very important characteristic in triangles is that the sum of the angles is 180 degrees. So in this case, angle A plus angle B plus angle C is 180 degrees. And if we know this relationship, then if we know any two of the angles, we can figure out the third. For example, if we say that in triangle RST, now when we just say triangle RST, it means that the vertex points, you see, for drawing the triangle are at points that are labeled R, S, and T. All right, with that in mind, angle R is 32 degrees, angle S is 88 degrees. Let's find angle T. Well, we use this relationship. We say that we know that in triangle RST, it must be true that angle R plus angle S plus angle T is equal to 180 degrees. And now what do we know? We know angle R is 32. We know that angle S is 88. We're looking for angle T, and we know the sum is 180. And we go through and solve from here. We would add these two, you see, and let's see, what would we get? 8 and 2 is 10, 8 and 3, 11, 1, 12. So this is 120 degrees plus angle T. I'm running out of room at the bottom of the board, and I'm sure we can work it from here. We subtract 120 on both sides, and when we subtract 120 from the 180, we get 60 degrees. So angle T then turns out to be 60 degrees in a couple of steps. One special kind of triangle is a right triangle, and it's special because it's a triangle in which there is one right angle. And in a right triangle, generally that right angle is designated with this little corner indicator that we have seen before. Now, with right triangles, the side which is opposite the right angle is called the hypotenuse. Don't you love that word, hypotenuse? And the other two sides are called legs. So we have a hypotenuse and legs involved with right triangles. Now, the one really nice thing about right triangles, too, is that if we have a right angle right here, that's an angle of 90 degrees. And we know that the sum of the measures of all of the angles is 180, and 90 of those degrees are right here, then those two angles must total the other 90 degrees in the triangle. So if we know that we have a right triangle, and we know that angle A, for example, is 60 degrees, we can find B. We don't have to be told the size of angle C. We know its size because it's labeled. We have a right triangle here. We have this labeling which indicates 90 degrees. And for that reason, these two total also 90. And so angle A plus angle B equals 90 degrees. And we know that angle A is 60. And so we can solve this little equation to find angle B, subtracting 60 on both sides. We find that angle B is 30 degrees. Quadrilaterals are generally just four-sided figures, four-sided closed figures, four-sided closed plane figures. You see, they're all in the same plane, and they are closed because their endpoints meet and that kind of thing. The quad business, this prefix means four. Quadrilateral means four-sided figures. Okay, so this is a four-sided figure. There's one. They can come with a lot of appearances. There are several that are special that we want to talk about particularly. The rectangle, and I'm sure you've seen rectangles before, a rectangle is a quadrilateral, a special quadrilateral. It's a quadrilateral in which opposite sides are the same length and the angles are all right angles. So all of these angles are right angles when we have a rectangle. A parallelogram can be thought of as just kind of a leaning rectangle. We have a rectangle situation, but it kind of leans over, and so the angles aren't right angles. But we do have a situation where opposite sides are the same length, and it does turn out that those opposite sides are also parallel, hence the name parallelogram. You see, these two sides are parallel, those two sides are parallel, these two are the same length, those two are the same length. And the only difference between the parallelogram and the rectangle is the notion that here we have right angles and here we don't. The square, and again, you're familiar with the square. I guess you could think of a square as a very particular kind of rectangle, couldn't you? After all, you have opposite sides are the same length, just as we had with the rectangle. All the angles are right angles, just as we had with the rectangle. But there's one other thing. All the sides happen to be the same length. So every one of these sides are the same length for the square. A circle is defined as all the points in a plane which are the same distance from a center point. So here the circle would be the set of points that surround that center. And the center would usually be labeled with a letter, and I haven't done that here because I'll get jammed up with some other stuff. But here is the center of the circle. A segment which goes from one point on a circle to another point on a circle and goes through the center is called the diameter. And I should say this is a diameter because there are many of them. This segment would be a diameter. This segment, you see, going through the center would be a diameter. I could draw one right here, a diameter. Now, they're all the same distance, but I can draw it in a lot of different ways. Now, a segment which goes from the center to the edge of the circle, like this, and it could be drawn anywhere, from right here, right there, right here, all anywhere. Just from the center to the circle itself is called a radius. It should be clear that a radius, and I'll swing this up right here, that's a radius, and I could swing it over here, and this would be a radius. You see, the radius and diameter are related to one another in that if we take two of these radius lengths, then we have a diameter. And so the diameter is two times the radius, or the radius is 1/2 of the diameter. It's just another way of looking at it. Suppose we know that the diameter is 8 inches and we want to find the radius. Well, we can write a little relationship if we want to. We can say, well, the radius is 1/2 the diameter. We know the diameter is 8, so the radius then is 1/2 of 8, which is 4. So the radius is 4 inches. Geometric solids. Now, when the word solid is used, it implies a three-dimensional quality. That is, we're not restricted to a plane surface, a flat surface. We have a three-dimensional quality involved in solids. This is a rectangular solid, and we kind of saw this a little bit ago when I first drew an illustration of a solid. Now, the idea with rectangular solids and all solids is that there is a depth involved in them, and it's not an easy task always to draw these things. Let me give you a hint, though, about drawing them. This is the way I first learned how to draw these, and if you're interested in doing this, what you do is you draw like one surface, like the front surface, and then you draw the back, and a pretty good way to do it, and this doesn't come from mechanical drawing, but and you don't get a true depth perception here, but it's a pretty good way of drawing stuff like this. You make a rectangle just like this right here. Just make another one and just try to make it as similar to this first one as possible, and now just connect like this. You see, and now you have a box, what looks like a box. Now, I've done this, and I've put this dotted business to try to show that this side is in the front, and that one I can also see, and I can see the top. What I can't see is the back, and therefore the dotted stuff is what I can't see. You see, it's often depicted that way. You'll see some nice illustrations in your textbook. Well, at any rate, we have involved with this rectangular solid, we think about the a length, width, and height situation, and the lower side, bottom, a lot of times is the length. The width would be this, and the height, how high it is, would be here. So length, width, and height. A cube is just kind of a special kind of rectangular solid, I guess you could say, because all of the sides are the same length. So the length, the width, and the height are all the same length. So for a cube. Now, a sphere, this one is especially difficult to draw because you're trying to show a three-dimensional quality in a circular kind of thing. If I brought a basketball out here or a baseball, we could illustrate it rather easily. But here's a picture of a sphere, and the dotted part is presumably we're kind of going around the middle of the figure. It's kind of like having a globe, and we have the equator right here, and we can see it on this side, and we can't see it on the other side. That's the idea. But there's a center involved, and we have this diameter and radius notion involved with sphere as well. And if we're going from any point on the surface of the sphere, you see the sphere is the collection of all of the points on the surface of this round object thing. And if you go from that surface down to the center, then you have a radius. And if you go from a point over here and go through that center all the way to the other side, you have a diameter. And the radius-diameter relationship is the same as it was before. That is, the radius is half of the diameter, or we could say the diameter is twice the radius. A cylinder is another three-dimensional type object. It's another solid. And the cylinder is illustrated with lots of cans have this kind of appearance. And there is a base notion, the bottom of it, what it appears to rest upon is its base, and the height is what we would typically think of as the height of the figure. Now, notice that the base is circular here for a cylinder, and that's an important aspect. So we have a circular base, and then the side just kind of goes straight up, and there's a circular top as well. All cans are like that, soda cans, for example. And so we have this relationship between radius and diameter on our base, our lower base or the upper base, we might call it. Suppose the radius of the base is 8 centimeters. Suppose we want to find the diameter. Well, we know that the relationship is that the diameter is 2 times the radius. You see, now a few minutes ago I had another formula here, and I kind of invented the two formulas just by the nature of the relationship between radius and diameter. These are not formulas to be memorized, they are just to be understood. We understand the relationship between diameter and radius, we can make the formula as we need them. That's the idea. So the diameter is twice the radius, the diameter then is 2 times, the radius here is 8 centimeters, so 2 times 8, 16, so 16 centimeters then would be the diameter. Let's talk about a couple of problems. We're going back to triangles here. And notice the notation I'm using for to save some space here, and I think we can follow this. Two angles, the little angle symbol with an S, angles. Two angles of a triangle measure 42 degrees and 103 degrees. Find the measure of the third angle. Well, again, we use the idea that the sum of the measures of the angles is 180 degrees in triangles. And so we go through and we make some kind of equation, or we could just work this arithmetically if you'd like to. But if we make an equation, we're really safe in doing it that way. Now, I can label these angles anything I want to. There's no labeling for the triangle up here. We haven't called it triangle ABC or anything like that. But we could do that for the purpose of our equation, or we could do this. We could say angle 1 plus angle 2 plus angle 3 is 180. You see, and just label a couple of them as the 42 and the 103. So 42 plus 103 plus this third angle is 180. Now adding these two, we get 145 plus angle 3 is 180. And we have to show the subtraction of 145 on both sides. And when we do that, when we subtract 145 over here, this will go out. When we subtract 145 over here, we get 35 as the difference. And so we find out then that angle 3 is equal to 35 degrees. Now, I didn't show that other step, and I should, but I didn't show it because we're getting jammed up here with the other problem. One angle of a right triangle measures 20 degrees. Find the measure of the other angles. You see, there are three angles in the triangle. We have only one of the angles as 20 degrees. But we're told we have a right triangle. So for these other angles, you see there are two other angles besides the 20 degree angle, but we know that one of them is the right angle. So we know one of them is 90 degrees. So we need that third angle, you see. And we know that the two angles that are not the right angle add to be 90. And so we might say angle A plus angle B is equal to 90 degrees. And let's call this angle A. You see, and now we can subtract 20 on both sides. It's a rather trivial situation, but a couple of steps later we find that angle B is equal to, let's say 90 minus 20 would be 70. So the three angles are the 20 degree angle that's given, and the other two angles are 90 degrees and 70 degrees. If two lines are in the same plane, then they either intersect or they don't intersect. We mentioned that before. If they don't intersect, they're called parallel lines. And if they do intersect, a number of situations are possible. They could intersect in such a way that a right angle is formed. And we said that in such a case, the lines are said to be perpendicular to one another. Well, what if the lines intersect and a right angle is not formed? Then the intersection might look something like this. Now, in this circumstance, notice that two of the angles that are formed are acute angles and the other two angles are obtuse angles. That'll always be the case when the intersecting lines don't form right angles. Now, we have a label for the situation with the various angles. Angles which kind of oppose one another, or they are opposite one another, are called vertical angles. So W and Y would be vertical angles, and X and Z would be vertical angles. So W and Y, angle W and angle Y would be vertical. Angle X and angle Z are vertical angles. And it turns out that they are equal to one another. That is, vertical angles are equal to one another. And it kind of looks like that here. It goes with our intuition involved in this situation. Now, another designation is that angles which are kind of next to one another, angles which share a side, you see, are called adjacent angles. Now, adjacent angles, notice that these two angles are adjacent, and notice that the two angles together form a straight angle. You see, form this entire straight angle, and so they are therefore supplementary. So adjacent angles are supplementary. Let's just label the adjacent angles here. X and Y are adjacent. Y and Z are adjacent. Z and W are adjacent. And W and X are adjacent. Whoops, need an angle. And all of these pairs of angles are supplements of one another. You see, these two total 180, those two total 180, those two total 180, and so forth. All right, so that's the idea. Suppose I'm told that angle X is 120 degrees, that is, angle X, this angle right here. Let's say it's 120 degrees. Can we find the measures of all the other angles? Sure we can. And it's not too difficult because, after all, angle X and angle Z are vertical angles and therefore they are equal. And so angle Z is also 120 degrees. So I can just pop that information right in here. Now for angles W and Y, those are going to be equal to one another, but we have to calculate those by using this adjacent angle supplementary notion. These two angles are adjacent, they are supplements of one another, so the sum of their measures will be 180 degrees. So we say then that angle X plus angle Y is 180, and we know that X is 120. So we have this, and now subtracting 120 on both sides, I don't want to get into that other problem. The 120s go out here. We have angle Y then is 180 minus 120 is 60. So angle Y is 60. Let's go back up here. Angle Y is 60 degrees. And so here we have a 60 degree angle. And we notice that angle Y and angle W are vertical angles, so they are equal to each other. And so angle W is also a 60 degree angle. A rather special situation in geometry is one where we have two lines that are intersected by a third line. The third line is often referred to as a transversal. Now, a special situation involved in that is where the first two lines are parallel. Now, to have a transversal, the first two lines don't have to be parallel, but the parallel idea brings up a lot of situations that we want to talk about. If the first two lines are parallel, like L1 is parallel with L2 here, and the transversal, you see, two parallel lines are cut by a transversal, and the transversal intersects those two lines in such a way that a right angle is formed, then it turns out that eight right angles are going to be formed. All of the angles that are formed here are going to be right angles. Right angle here, 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 and all four of these are right angles as well. That's a very special situation. In geometry, you go about talking about, gee, if this transversal is perpendicular to one of the parallel lines, then it has to be perpendicular to the other, and all manner of items that come from that. But anyway, so here's one circumstance. Another circumstance that's a little more general than this is where the two parallel lines are cut by a transversal and the angle, one of the angles formed, is not a right angle. Well, in that situation, we have eight total angles, just as we did up here, but four of them will be acute and the other four will be obtuse. And we have a little cluster of four up here and a little cluster of four down here. And all of these angles have a relationship with one another. Now, we could take out this situation and say, well, the transversal intersects up here. And so we have a vertical angle situation up here. We have adjacent angles, you see, just like we talked about a little bit ago. But here we're talking about two groups of vertical angles, you see. And the lines are parallel. Now, let's talk about some particular terminology. I said a moment ago that four of the angles will be acute. These two are acute, those two are also acute, so all four of those acute. These two and these two are obtuse. And it turns out that angles which appear to be equal to one another are equal to one another. And so this is a highly intuitive kind of idea. Let's talk about alternate interior angles and alternate exterior angles. Now, we're talking about angles that are in this cluster and this cluster sort of compared to one another in this kind of discussion. And think about the region which is between the parallel lines as being in the interior of the figure, and the region that is sort of outside of the parallel lines or in the exterior of the figure. And that gives us a clue about alternate interior and alternate exterior angles. Now, for alternate interior angles, we're talking about a relationship involving angles within the interior. Okay, alternate interior angles are angles that are in separate clusters in the interior and on opposite sides of the transversal. That's a mouthful. Well, opposite sides of the transversal, you see, and then in separate clusters. So C and E are alternate interior angles. D and F are alternate interior angles. Interior, alternate on opposite sides, you see, and involving the two different clusters. Now, in a very similar way, alternate exterior angles, angles that are in the exterior. Alternate, meaning opposite sides of the transversal and involved with the two separate clusters. So alternate exterior, A and G, you see, are on opposite sides of the transversal. You see, and their exterior angles. All right, and B and H are also alternate exterior angles. And it turns out that all of these pairs of angles are equal to one another. That is, this A and G, alternate exterior angles. Gee, they're both acute angles, you see. They look like they're equal, and they are equal to one another. B and H, alternate exterior angles, they're equal to each other. D and F, alternate interior angles, they're equal. C and E, alternate interior, they're equal to one another. There is another angle pair kind of designation with corresponding angles. And let me spell angles correctly here. There we go. Corresponding angles are angles which occupy a corresponding position from one cluster to another. So B and F would be corresponding angles, A and E, corresponding angles, D and H, corresponding, C and G, corresponding angles. And it looks like that corresponding angles are equal to one another, and indeed that's the case as well. Okay, with that in mind, all we need is the measure of one of the angles in this grouping, and we can figure out all the rest of them rather easily, as a matter of fact. Suppose, for example, that we know that angle A is 30 degrees, that this angle is 30 degrees. Now let's try to find the measure of angle F. So we're targeting this one to find out something about. Now we can think through it by looking at the figure like this, or we can actually make some equations involving this situation. We actually ought to write down our thought process just a little bit here. We're trying to go from a situation where we're at angle A all the way down to angle F. Now they're clearly not equal to one another. This one's obtuse and that one is acute. But there are relationships all over the place, and there are a lot of right ways to deal with this. Now, one right way is this way, is to say, well, let's see, these two angles, angle A and angle B, gee, these involve these intersecting lines, these are adjacent angles. Adjacent angles are supplementary to one another, and so we could find the measure of angle B rather easily. I think, though, we're dealing with the words that are here with parallel lines cut by a transversal. Let's try to stay with the angles that are in this grouping. I can think about, let's see, this is an exterior angle. So think about the angle which is the alternate exterior angle with angle A. Alternate exterior, let's see, exterior, and on opposite sides of the transversal. So A and G are alternate exterior angles. All right, let's write that down. Angle A, now here's our problem. Angle A is 30 degrees, find angle F. But here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking that angle A and angle G from the figure
are alternate exterior angles. So that means then that angle A is equal to angle G, and if I know that angle A is 30 degrees, then I know that angle G is 30 degrees. All right, so I have that much. I have reasoned through to that point. So my reasoning is that this is a 30 degree angle. You see, now I've got a situation where, well, let's see, where I've got G and F are adjacent angles. And I said I was going to try to stay with only this terminology. Well, I can't. I've got to create a situation where I've got a relationship like this, and that relationship is one of supplements. And so since I know that these are supplements, I know that we have the sum of these two angles is 180. So angle G plus angle F equals 180, and G is 30 plus F is 180. Subtracting 30 on both sides I find angle F to be 150 degrees. So this angle is 150. Now let me label it 150. And what I want to point out here is how fast we can find all of the angles from some kind of strategy like this. That if this is 150, then this is 150 vertical angles. And if that's 150, then these two are also 150. They're all obtuse, you see, and they look equal, and so therefore they are. But H and B are alternate exteriors, you see, and therefore they're equal to one another. And F and D are alternate interiors, and so they are equal to one another. Trying to go with that terminology down here. And G and E are vertical angles, and so E is 30 degrees. And then C and E are alternate interior, and therefore C is 30 degrees. See, so this equality business all over the place. And I think we found all eight of them. Main thing was, though, that we found F to be 150 degrees.